The core of a tree is inert. Those inner rings once lived, breathed air, and felt the sun's warmth. Now dead, hardened, they form the backbone, the structural basis of the tree. It is a strange and beautiful sight. Each branch realizes its own idiosyncratic expression, all unique, but emanating from a single source.
I love leafless trees. I love winter trees because I can see their structure. I can see all the branches and how they connect to each other. I love the leaves too. And I love when they change colors, but when there are no leaves on the trees, I think they look gorgeous. I don't know whether I loved trees first or I loved the tree aspect of genealogy first, but regardless, I ended up with this passion for trees. I love their different growth patterns. And I think that same thing happens in genealogy too. They don't grow in nice, neat shapes. There are bunches of people in one part. There can be almost blank spots mm-hmm. in other parts of trees. Mm-hmm. It's just not regular. It's not just finding people with a birth date and a death date. It's all their stories. And then you find how the stories are interconnected. It's like my mom's family who came over in waves from Scotland. Between 1834 and 1882, they just came to this one town in Michigan because they were all talking to each other across the ocean. And they had this community in Scotland and they rebuilt it in Michigan.
So this is Clay, Washington Clay, and Amanda Allen, and these are my great-grandparents. They were the parents of my grandfather, Willie Clay, and they were married November 9th, 1871. So this room here at the Madison County Courthouse was where I first started doing research on my family. So when I found the marriage certificate, because that's the first one I found, of Washington and Amanda, I just started crying.
I started about 30 years ago. I had a cousin who did a family tree, and I saw it. And I bought a program for my computer where you could build trees, and I used her tree as a beginning, and I just added on to it. So if I had a relative who was born, say, in 1890, I would go to like an 1870 census and find their parents, and I would just extend the tree.
Once you find one relative, you want to find more.
I mean, you sort of go as long as you're interested and you can keep finding new information.
It evolved. You know, I just started, you know, to create a tree and to expand the tree, and I just got hooked on it and just did more and more. And the more I find, the more I want to find.
It's like eating potato chips. And you just can't stop.
You're up hours
late.
Hours and hours.
3 a.m. I better go to bed.
Yeah. And you have books and papers and resources in your...
Before I had kids waiting for me the next morning.
Yeah.
I had to get them off to school.
It's an obsession. Yeah. It becomes an addiction.
But I had it laminated, and I thought, and this was all the stuff that I had on the table.
Oh, this is about you doing your research.
It's about, and this is when I first started doing it. And then that June is when I came. But that's really funny that's funny. There.
You can't talk to everyone about genealogy because everyone's not there and everyone's not interested. So even when I talked to my siblings, they were like, if you say one more thing about Henry or John Clay, we're going to shoot you in the forehead. But then they ask you. And then you can't just give one answer. You have to bring out the charts and you have to show them.
In 2003, I began my research tracing the ancestries of the English clay family who settled in Virginia. An Englishman by the name of John Clay arrived in Jamestown in 1613. In Virginia, the descendants of John Clay migrated, taking their slaves with them to areas such as Henrico, Giles, Bedford, Pennsylvania, Albemarle, Madison, and Chesterfield counties. My mission was to try to find out which particular Clay had owned my relatives. Madison County was the home county of my ancestors. Henry Clay is recorded as a mulatto on the 1870 census. Was he of mixed African and European ancestry? Is our family biologically connected to the English Clays, or do we simply share a surname? Was his father a white Clay? If so, who was his father? Who was his mother? I continue to search for answers to many of these questions. I remember the first gathering that I attended, and one of the ladies that was a speaker, she said something that was really important to me because I'm just new at this. She said, you have to document everything. Mm-hmm. I don't care who tells you. I don't care if it's a cousin, a relative, the neighbor. Make sure you write it down in case it's wrong, and then you can go back and correct it.
I have been a careful documenter of sources for a long time. In the beginning, I wasn't. I was just banging names into a tree. And I didn't write down where I got it. And I can tell which of those old records are my early records
because
they don't have any sources. Mm-mm. Any genealogy software worth its salt provides for sources. Mm-hmm. So I put it all in there, even if it's kind of half baked.
Mm-hmm.
But see, that's one reason I never publish my tree.
Because, yeah, you said that.
Because it's a lot of it is a work in progress.
Mm-hmm.
And if I put it out there, somebody's going to take it and run with it.
They will.
And I can't guarantee it because I'm still working on it.
Yeah.
I can tell by looking at my sources which ones are really good, like primary sources, and which ones are not.
Yeah.
But I can tell that. Mm-hmm. If I turn it over to someone else,
they're not going to do it. And then that's Elmo. So he was my father's first cousin.
Okay.
And it even has a little story finding Elmo. My father, Russell Clay, worked for the ice house, and he was the ice man. He delivered ice. So when refrigeration started to become, you know, modernized, there was not really a need for block ice anymore. The lady that he worked with owned the ice house. Her name was Mary. And Mary said, you know, Russell, I'm going to sell my business, but don't worry about a job. Well, as it turned out, she was friends with the people who owned the mill. And she went and said, you know, my employee needs a job. And he worked there, and he retired from there. He worked there for 42 years as a machinist. He was an athlete, played basketball, played baseball, loved to hunt deer, squirrel, was very responsible with firearms. My father said he didn't have any cousins, that they had died, he didn't know where they were. And that was his way of saying, I don't know. And so since I don't know, I'm going to tell you they're dead. And that was not acceptable. And so I had a friend who was also really a professional genealogist. His name was Julian Burke. Julian Burke said, I think I found one of your father's cousins. And so he sent me the information, and the guy's name was Elmo Clay. And he said, and he's alive. I haven't found any death records. So we traveled to Sperryville, Virginia. We went past this little apple stand, and there was a little woman there named Mary. And I said, Mary, do you know Elmo Clay? And she said, yeah, I know that rascal. He works down there at the Sperryville Emporium. So we got in the car, and we went. went to the Sperryville Emporium. When we arrived, we parked, we went inside. We didn't notice him sitting to the left of us. He was sitting on the porch. So when we went inside, we asked the clerk, and we said, does Elmo Clay work here? She said, yes. She said, he's sitting out there on the porch taking a break. So I said, okay. So we went out, and his back was to us, and he was sitting in a rocking chair. So as we approached him, I said, hello. I said, are you Elmo Clay? And he turned his face around, he turned around, and he said, well, it depends. He said, are you the law? And we said, no. We said, we're your relatives. And he said, I don't have any relatives that look like you. And I said, you do. I said, you've never met me. You don't know me. But let me tell you how we're connected. And his father's name was Ashby Clay. And Ashby was the brother of my grandfather, Willie Clay. So since I knew the name of his father, he knew that I was probably kinfolk. Yeah. So he said, this is a miracle. He said, I just can't believe this. So he said, I want to learn more. And we sat on the porch and talked. And he started crying. He said, I'm so happy to meet you. Well, the next day I got a call from a lady, and her name was Emma Clay, Elmo's sister. And she said to me, she said, I have prayed all of my life that my family would come and find me. I knew that I had cousins out there, but I didn't know what happened to them. And so when I shared this story with my father, I said, do you remember? And he said, yes, now I remember Elmo. He didn't remember Emma, but he remembered Elmo, because during that period of time, you know, people would have the homecomings. They would come home and have picnics and meet at the church. And so on one of those particular gatherings, my father was about 7, and Elmo was maybe 4 or 5, and they were playing, and Elmo threw a frog on him. This is the place where his cousin, Elmo, threw the frog on him. So near to the church, and that's how he remembered Elmo and his name. And so we reunited, we got everybody together, all both my side of the family and their side of the family. And then we met in Kaiser, West Virginia, and it was a beautiful, beautiful reunion. And so then he, my father, Elmo, and Emma stayed in contact since that time. Now they're all transitioned now. But I think it was the greatest gift that I received during all of this research. During the 1930s, families such as the Twymans, Johnsons, and Garlands, into which my family married, migrated from Madison and Albemarle counties to Piedmont, West Virginia. They moved to improve their socioeconomic opportunities and status. My grandparents lived on Aaron Street, and then that was also the home place of Ella Clay Twyman, who was the daughter of Henry Clay. So she is the first one that I know about that came from Crigler'sville and actually settled in Piedmont from Madison County. Right here, in this structure there, I'll turn around, that used to be where Nanny Ma lived. That was the old home place. And then this big hole right here is the church. So that was the church. One of the founders of the church was my grandfather, William Willie Clay. The interesting thing is that a lot of the people that moved to this area, they moved from, you know, Moorefield and Petersburg and other parts of West Virginia, and they settled in Piedmont because there was economic opportunity in Piedmont. My house would have been like right here. It would have been here. And we had a couple of steps, probably went to that part because it wasn't the whole footprint. And then, you know, we had like a single door and a little porch, come up on the porch, and this was home. So now my home is a basketball court. We had a little teeny tiny bathroom, and it had a teeny tiny window. And so I could always hear the water, but the best place to look at it was out of that little window. And I would look out the window and see the river. So it was probably here, like a little bit here. And the house, you know, it was a two-story home. So I could look out the window and I could see everything that was going on with the river and everything that was going on in Westernport. And it was just reassuring because I saw it every day. It's even generating some memories that I haven't had in a long time. Warm memories, good memories. And my father, again, because this was our backyard, and my father, our house had a basement on it, and he would always be in the basement, digging stuff out of the basement. But this space here, and a little bit more, because we had more yard than this. So, you know, the basketball court's taking up some of the yard. We had so much fun. You know, we had cookouts and birthday parties and graduation parties. It all happened here. And that's why I think so important about our history, because no one would ever know, not unless we told them. They wouldn't know that this used to be the place of Russell and Sue and Cindy and Rusty and Gay and Beaver. This is the place that nurtured us.
I was never the history type guy. I just constantly would believe in my dad. We would go back and we'd say, hey, damn, you got uncles and all of this type of stuff. Oh boy, all them people are dead.
Mom and Dad didn't talk about their life too much. Mm-hmm. You'd ask them questions and they'd tell you what you wanted to hear. Mm-hmm. But outside of that, beyond that, you know, all he knew, all Dad would always say, oh boy, don't worry about it.
Yeah.
Just live. Yeah. You know? But they were private people.
Very private.
And
yeah.
They probably went through a lot in their younger life that mm-hmm.
they
probably didn't want
to know
talk about.
They didn't
want
to know.
And I would just tell my wife all the time, man, they, you know how you would go. Like, if you went to the doctors, first time you ever go to a doctor, they want to know your family history, mm-hmm. health-wise.
Didn't know.
I didn't know. Yeah, I couldn't tell know. Them. Uh-uh. I could just tell them what's going on today with me or whoever's going.
It wasn't shared.
They didn't share because they was private people. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
My parents were divorced. And so I lived with my grandmother after their divorce for many years. And so, unlike some of my other cousins who also lived with her from time to time, she was my primary caretaker. She was essentially my mother. So I learned a lot about her and a lot about the family history.
That's how I learned about Washington Clay, was through Grandma Laura. Mm-hmm. When I had Whitney, mm-hmm. she came to D.C. and Grandma and I had some little bourbon.
I bet it came out then, didn't it?
I did. More than I said, Grandma, now yeah. hold on a minute. You're getting a little bit limpy over there. But it was one of the best moments I've ever had with her because it was woman to woman.
Mm-hmm. Mom knew a lot. She knew a lot about us. Mom, she went through a lot mm-hmm. that probably we'll never know.
No, we'll never know.
You know, but she went through it. Mm-hmm. It didn't change her personality.
No.
Like we said earlier, Mom was one of the most gentle, meekest. She wasn't a weak person.
No, not weak at all.
She was not weak at all,
no.
But she was gentle.
Gentle,
and that I think that radiates through some of us.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, some. Yeah. Some.
But still, it's in some of us.
It is. You know, sometimes in families, when the grandma dies or the grandparents go, then the family doesn't stay close together.
It seems like
You do. And I think in a lot of ways that's what has happened to our family.
My grandmother, they never talked about any kind of racial problems that they had. She loved coming to Virginia and Crigler'sville, my father said, you know, when they were younger. And then when I lived with her, she was a lot older, and they would make a day trip with Mr. Doug Twyman and come and buy stuff. I mean, they'd leave like 5 a.m. and come back 11 o'clock at night.
Grandma and Granddaddy went to Crigler'sville because that's where they were from.
Just about every year around Labor Day weekend.
So they went back to visit family. Then I guess at some point in time, they whatever, you know, money or family or obligations, they didn't go. And I think that's how the families got separated.
Right.
Yeah.
Right.
She always called Virginia home. And I didn't understand that until years later. I just thought they were taking her to a trip to Virginia. But when I think about it, both sides of her family were from Crigler'sville, the Price family and the Clay family. So many of them were probably still living here. And when they came to visit, you know, they had good food, good memories. She loved absolutely coming to Virginia. And I remember, almost like it was yesterday, Mr. Douglas Twyman would pull up in front of the house and pick her up, and he'd have other passengers in there too, and their home was this same place. So it was like a day trip. I don't remember her coming and staying overnight, but I never knew where she came. She just said Virginia, and it was here. She came to Crigler'sville. My father and his two older brothers, Uncle Paul and Uncle Luther, when they were young boys, they traveled from Piedmont, West Virginia, here to Madison County, and helped work on Uncle Wayman and work with Uncle Thomas on their farms because they didn't have sons. Uncle Wayman didn't have any children. And he spoke fondly about it, but he also said he would not want to live in a community where he had to be a farmer because the work was too hard.
No wonder my grandmother wanted to always come and visit. It's absolutely beautiful. But at the same time, if you didn't want to work the land and we were moving into an industrial age, you had to move where the work was. So they ended up moving to West Virginia. My grandfather worked in the West Virginia pulp and paper mill.
For some reason, I didn't connect that his family was actually like my grandparents. I don't know why, probably just because I was too young. But I didn't connect my grandmother and my grandfather, my father's parents, to being from here. I thought they were from Piedmont. For some reason, I didn't connect that. So maybe I thought that his uncle moved to Virginia and lived here. I didn't connect those dots until I came here, till I moved here. I didn't know they were from here.
When I first came to the area and asked the Historical Society, they said, go talk to Miss Lottie Banks. She can give you, she knows everything. And she did. And she was friends with Thomas Clay, my uncle. But she told me everything. She was such a joy. And I drove her around and she showed me places and she told me about my family. And the one thing that she told me, she said, oh, honey, she said, I don't want to, you know, make you feel embarrassed. She said, but the men in your family are kind of cheapskates. And I said, I already know that. So we had a good laugh, but it's just very interesting that she's right here, right next to my family.
Don't you have a questionable generation in there? You're not sure.
The questionable, we don't know who Henry's parents were.
Your Henry.
My Henry.
Not Henry III.
Right. My fourth great grandfather, his name was Henry Clay, and he was from Madison County, Virginia. I didn't learn about him until I moved to Virginia about 18 years ago. His first wife was Judy Clay, and that's who I descend. He and Judy had three sons. He and Mariah had one daughter,
and that daughter ended up in Piedmont, West Virginia.
All I know is that he was a farmer. I find him owning real estate and having a will and buying things, and even on the census. I still do not know the names of my Henry Clay's parents. On his wedding license, on information, census, it always says unknown. The census records listed him as a M, which meant mulatto. My understanding at that time was mulatto meant black and white heritage. Now, sometimes I learned later it could just have meant that the person had light skin, because a census taker could have written down whatever they thought they saw. But it sparked a curiosity in me to say, well, if he was mulatto, he probably had a white father, and that was probably a Clay. So I reached out to an organization, and I'm not sure how I even found it, honestly, but it was called the Clay Family Society. And when I reached out to the Clay Family Society, I got a response from one of the members, and her name was Virginia Cook. And so we instantly bonded, and she said, I can tell you everything that I know, and she was very helpful. And at that point in time, the Clay Family Society, they were doing the DNA test, but they were only doing it on males. And I wasn't sure. I mean, I didn't know. This was all really a new science. I didn't know. So I asked my brother, Roderick, who we call Beaver, if he would submit to the DNA test. So we both did the DNA test. And when the results came back, they said that our heritage, that we were part Norwegian, I was like, wait a minute, let's send this thing back. So we resubmitted, and it came back again, and it said, there's not a mistake. Part of your heritage is Norwegian. And then we found out later that was accurate, but that was taking it far back, which meant there were some people that were Norwegian, probably ended up in England, tracing back. But at the time, we didn't know all these things.
Virginia was actually the first colony to institute a law called partus sequitur ventrum. It's from the Latin, and it essentially means the status of the child follows the status of the mother. And this was a law instituted in 1662. And so what this recognized is that enslaved women's children would be enslaved regardless of the status of the father. And so what it did too was, in some ways, it recognized the kind of illicit relationships between slave black women and white men. It kind of exculpated white men from having to take responsibility for children that they fathered with black women. And so this happens fairly soon in the kind of history of legal slavery in the American colonies that would become the United States.
When I was in the fourth grade, we were studying slavery. And so I remember seeing images in this book. And there was a picture of slaves, and there was a picture of Henry Clay. And because my family, we were the only family in our community with the last name Clay, with a fourth grade little girl in mind, I thought, well, maybe he's my relative. So I asked my teacher, and I said, do you think Henry Clay could be related to me? And she said, no, honey, I don't think he was related to your family. And so then I asked her, because we were studying slavery, do you think that he could have owned my family? And she said, that could have been a possibility. So that was the first time that I made a connection as a child. Many years later, I wondered if he had been black, would her response have been, oh, maybe. Mm-hmm. But the fact that he was prominent, he was white,
You know, and I was a little black girl, the chances of that, you know, would have been slim to none. And I think that if it had not been just for my curiosity as a child, looking at Henry Clay's picture.
Senator Henry Clay.
Right.
That is another Henry Clay.
I didn't know
he's
that.
He's the great-grandson of Henry III, the Indian trader.
Yes.
Okay. I began in 1984 researching the Clay family, descendants of Henry Clay. And this is a gigantic family. It is a creative family. They've been in virtually every walk of life that you can think about. My first research was on a great-granddaughter who was a poet. And then I just moved from that, began to get to know members of the family, began to hear what they had to say about their own experiences in the 20th century and early 21st, and moved on into the family history. And it's never ending. You know, you just constantly find out new things about them.
My name is Ian Ralby. I am the fifth great grandson of Henry Clay. I am descended through Henry Clay Jr.'s line. I was somewhat unusual in that I began studying law at the age of 19, and I ended up going to William & Mary. And I'd always had a fascination with William & Mary given its history, but I had not in any way studied the history of the law school's connection to Henry Clay through its first professor, George Wythe. And when I got to the law school, there's a statue of George Wythe and John Marshall, the great Chief Justice the early days of the Supreme Court, in front of the law school with a series of names of George Wythe's most famous students, and among them is Henry Clay. I think at that point, it kind of captured my imagination a little bit, and so I got a little bit more interested in studying the history, but I don't think I really dug deep. It wasn't until I was an adult and I was actually working in international affairs that I began to really take an interest in not just the sort of textbook understanding of Henry Clay, but more of Henry Clay as a person and why it was that he had such an impact on the fabric of this country.
You know, he's increasingly not remembered, which I think is unfortunate, but I may be a little bit biased there. But he is still probably one of the best known non-presidents of the 19th century. He is a gifted farmer. He grew up in Virginia until he was a young man. He was an amanuensis, a secretary for George Wythe. He knew of some of the things that George Washington was doing agriculturally, Thomas Jefferson was doing, the better farmers of that period. And he remained what I would call a scientific farmer and had a tremendous impact upon agriculture in this part of the country. His education was not particularly good. He could not reel off long passages in Latin and things like that, like Daniel Webster could and some of his contemporaries. His education was, I think, more self-generated. He went as a country rube to work in an apothecary when his father and mother moved to Kentucky. His stepfather and his mother. He was 14 years old and left pretty much on his own. But he quickly realized what the norm was. He learned how to dress. He learned what people were interested in. That's what got him into drinking a little bit more than he probably should have when he was younger. And some things like gambling, which he did more of than he should have when he was younger. But he quickly realized where people were coming from. You know, John Adams, when he went to Ghent as a representative of the United States, John Adams said he's playing brag with the British. Brag was a game like poker, and Clay could tell when people were bluffing.
He was a great orator, but he was probably not the best. He was a great negotiator, but probably not the best. He was great at certain legislative aspects, but probably not the best. But as an aggregate, he had an impact that very few have ever had.
He went to Ghent as a diplomat, signing the Treaty of Ghent that ended the War of 1812. He was Secretary of State under John Quincy Adams, the 4 years of John Quincy Adams' presidency, but then pretty much stuck to the Senate thereafter. Totally over 50 years in the House of Representatives and the Senate. It was roughly a 50-year run.
Ashland is many things. By name, it is Ashland, the Henry Clay Estate. So it is where Henry Clay lived. It is what remains of the farm he developed. It is the place where his legacy is preserved, interpreted, and made available to the public. Our research shows that there were about 120 people enslaved here from 1797 until 1865. If you look at his writings, etc., at an early age, he's writing some pretty virulently anti-slavery things. He writes under a pen name, Scaviola. That probably results from the fact that the man who educated him in law in Richmond was a man named George Wythe, who had emancipated all of the people he enslaved and had become an advocate of abolition. Now, if you look at his views in terms of the people he enslaved and of the institution of slavery, say, here at Ashland, they don't waver much. He starts enslaving people on arrival in Lexington. He's already inherited to. He picks up a few more in short order, and it just goes upward from there. And, you know, over the course of years, he emancipates a few. We now have records of 7. But when you compare that to the 120 enslaved here, it's a drop in the bucket. I think it's quite clear that he was quite comfortable accepting that these were not people, but rather property, and that that was their proper place, and he was quite comfortable engaging in the enslavement of these people. We are in the process of building a descendant community. That would include people descended from the people enslaved at Ashland, or even people whose descent is from enslaved people at Ashland and perhaps white clay. That was a common phenomenon at places like Ashland. It would be unreasonable to believe that it never happened here. We have a number of individuals with whom we are working. In all of those cases, we're still working very hard to fully understand their ancestry and to determine who their ancestors were that were enslaved at Ashland.
You know, the issue now is, how do you find descendants? How do you piece that story back together? And it's not an easy thing to do. It's going to be a slow process, but it is being worked on.
One of the challenging parts of kind of tracing family histories of people of African descent in the United States is that while these records are kind of available, oftentimes they are not very clear. So, for example, enslaved people often were not recorded with last names.
Oftentimes, people enslaved at Ashland only are ever identified by a first name. It makes it very difficult, thence, to find those people in records after enslavement. How do you know that the Tom you're finding in that record after enslavement is in fact the one enslaved at Ashland? Sometimes it will say, or it will give, you know, an age or something like that that you can kind of correlate, but a lot of times it doesn't, so it's very difficult.
In a case like me, who I'm descended from, Africans and Europeans, those records for my Africans are totally non-existent in some way. So we'll never find, that's why my Henry Clay, and I don't like to use the word never because I want to have hope, but so far it's been 15 years and I've never been able to find his parents.
So it makes this type of research really, really difficult and challenging, which is probably why DNA tests are becoming increasingly more popular within African-American communities. People who want to be able to trace some type of lineage as far back as possible.
Do
do your DNA results, you know, they've been fine-tuning those, the autosomal results.
Mm-hmm.
Do they, are you now able to say what part of Africa?
It is current-day Nigeria, mm-hmm. and Ghana, and that goes back 400 years. So we know that they came from the West.
Right.
When you submit your DNA for analysis, for genetic genealogy purposes, they essentially extract your DNA from the saliva sample. And then from there, they go through a process of genotyping, as they call it. They're reading all of the A's and C's and G's and T's that make up your DNA at the various places on the genome that they test for. From there, they use that information and look at the patterns in your DNA to, one, see how they are similar to various reference populations in Africa versus Europe versus Asia versus the Americas. But then there is another type of comparison that is done. Instead of just seeing how similar your DNA is to that of various reference populations, they instead look at what pieces of DNA you have that are identical to those found in other individuals in their database. Because those identical pieces of DNA were inherited from a common ancestor. When you are looking to go deeper into the past, you want to utilize Y chromosome DNA. And that's the DNA that is passed down from father to son each generation, meaning that this type of DNA will only be useful for cases where it involves a male ancestor who has had sons, who have had sons, who have had sons, who have had sons.
So a couple of years later, when DNA became more advanced and progressive, a few members of the society said, Leontyne, what you need to look at, the DNA that we were doing was on the male line. We didn't do the female. So they said you could descend from a woman.
Everyone has mitochondrial DNA, but only women can pass it down to the next generation. So it's good for tracing one's mother's, 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 mother's line.
What we discovered is that there were two ladies in the DNA database who matched me, and they both descended from Mitchell Clay, which meant that I descended from Mitchell Clay, but through a female. So we think that Mitchell Jr., the way that this would have to be genetically, had a daughter, because we're on the female side, had a daughter with an enslaved woman, and then that enslaved woman went on and had Henry.
Henry.
That's right. The only way that it could
That's
have worked.
That's why they can't do Y-DNA.
Yeah.
Because they don't have, they're not male clays. They're
we're female clays. We're female
it's very
clays.
Very inconvenient.
It is. Mitchell Clay Jr. had an enslaved woman. And my thought, because I'm descended from a female, is that he and Phoebe had a child together who was a female. That female, I don't know what her name was. And she ends up, I believe, having Henry. Now, did she die in Giles County and never make it to Madison County? Was she sold away? Or did she come to Madison County and she died and left him there? I have no idea. So what I had to do is find out, where was Mitchell Clay from? Where did he go? When was he born? Who was his wife? Because this meant that his story was my story too, but it was connected through also through an enslaved person, and more than likely an enslaved woman.
And then people have asked, they said, well, why would you, I mean, people have asked me, why do you want to know about these white people?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
They've asked me that. Black people have asked me that. And I said, because that's my family. I mean, that truly is. That's truly my family, regardless of history.
I was literally in the middle of reading about some of those contradictory statements and practices of Henry Clay regarding slavery when I got an email out of the blue from Leontyne Clay Peck. And at the time, I had never heard of her. I looked her up and immediately realized we had a distant but pretty clear familial connection. And I was very excited to actually start to open up communication with others from whom I share a common ancestor. The point is to say, you know, okay, we have this common ancestor, what can we do together?
This is where Mary and I first connected.
I think you did tell me. I remember being in our meeting room in Williamsburg at the Woodlands.
Yeah.
Where you said that you were descended from Mitchell. And I did not know. I don't think I knew that.
Mary and I have known each other for a very long time. We didn't know initially that we were both descended from Mitchell. That didn't happen until I connected with my two DNA matches. Mary had all the information. I had bits and pieces of information. But through her, I was able to put the puzzle together. So for me, Mary has been a wonderful resource. Even if Mary and I were not connected, I think we'd be friends because we both like organization, we both like art, we like to read, we have the same type of humor. I think we have a lot of personality traits that are similar. Captain John Smith, Governor of Virginia.
They have recreated the fence line of the fort as best they can. And this is where they had to stop.
Mm-hmm.
Went out in a triangle out there and back, trapped in the water.
And salt in the river may have caused a variety of illnesses. There was no well on the island until 1608, when John Smith reports digging a farewell of fresh water.
Yeah. Because this, all the water here is bracken.
Yeah.
Little round leaves like that. A lot of them.
Oh, they do have different leaves, don't they?
You find these more like in North Carolina, South Carolina, Georgia.
Wow.
It's a different planting zone. John, Charles, Henry, the Indian trader, as in someone who trades with Indian, not someone who trades with Indian.
Yeah.
But he did kidnap some.
They did.
And then William Mitchell Sr., he's our common ancestor. Mm-hmm. I call him Mitchell 5. It's John 1, Charles 2, Henry 3, William 4, Mitchell 5.
Mm-hmm.
And so it's that fifth generation after John that we share.
Ancestor was simply named John Clay. We know little about John Clay. We know that he arrived on the Treasurer in 1613. We know that his great-grandson was Senator Henry Clay. We know that John Clay had two wives. One was named Anne, the other named Elizabeth.
He was even here in 1617 or 18.
Mm-hmm. He could have been gone.
He'd already moved on.
Yeah.
Don't know.
We don't know. And, you know,
Because he wasn't important enough to show up on a plaque.
No, he was a regular. I think that's what Robert Young Clay was trying to make known, that he was a regular guy trying to search for a better life.
And all this myths about how he was from Wales, a coal baron's family, just a bunch of hooey.
Yeah.
And talk about drinking the Kool-Aid. It's all over the internet. People had bought it.
Mm-hmm.
There's nothing. There's no documentation to tell us anything about where John Clay came from.
Mm-hmm.
And Robert Young Clay is the one who sorted all that out.
Oh, I'm getting out of here.
It's documented that there were soldiers on the treasure on that voyage.
Then that would make sense to me.
And there's you can make a pretty good case that he was one of them.
Okay. Because, yeah. To me, that makes sense, that you're going to go where we're sending you, as opposed to him saying, hey, there's a place called Jamestown. I think I'm going to go there.
That ship came over in 1612. He was on it. It was that ship. It was sent over here to, like, rout out the French.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
It kind of went up and down the coast, and it didn't get here until, I don't know, maybe late 1612, and then again in 1613.
Mm-hmm.
I have to go read the history of it again. But we long ago got to the point where the only way we were going to figure out where John Clay, the first John Clay, came from was with DNA. There's a great reluctance in Europe, including England, to get their DNA tested. You know, there's a lot more concerns over there about privacy.
Yeah.
We have a Clay member in our society who lives over there, and he's sort of our boots on the ground person to help us identify male Clays who are willing to be tested. But he's had a hard time.
They don't want to do it. A lady on my mother's side, she contacted me, and she had been doing her family tree, and it kept circling back to my DNA and to my connection. On some of these platforms, they're a little larger now, but back then your image was very small, so you couldn't really tell, you know, you could really tell my ethnicity, you know. So she asked me, she said, were you black or white? And I said, I'm black. And so she said she didn't want to be black. And I said, well, that me being black doesn't make you black. And so she said, well, but I'm connected to you, the DNA, my great-great-grandfather. And so she told me the name. And I said, well, that name is familiar on my tree because that person was related to my maternal grandmother. That's why you connect to me. Now, you don't ever have to tell anybody in your family, only if you want. I'm not going to call your family up and tell them that they have black kinfolk. But she was upset. She was upset that she found black relatives.
There is a very, not just sad, but intentionally buried portion of our history. I think studying the fact that there are probably hundreds, if not thousands, of descendants in some way from the wider Henry Clay family, black and white and of all races, because of the nature of having been a slave-owning family, is quite instructive as to America's history. And until we do that, we're being overly selective, and we're creating a false narrative of descent.
And if you look particularly at black families, we're all colors. Everybody's in the family. We could all be all black people. We can't all be white people, but we can all be black people, because that's how it goes. That one drop. You got one drop.
You got that one drop.
Yeah. When people always ask me about the one drop, I always say, do you know, because most people have heard of Carol Channing, and she was a black woman.
Right, right.
And a lot of people don't know that. I said, well, look at Carol. She could hide it because she was light enough. And there are plenty of people who passed if they wanted to. But whenever Dr. Henry Louis Gates does Finding Your Roots, the one thing that he always finds is that white ancestor almost 100% of the time.
He finds him.
Yeah, and it's not by accident. Mm-hmm. It's because that's the reality of the history. Mm-hmm.
Back when I was a kid, living in Piedmont, and I learned about Henry Clay. But then we learned about, at the time, his name was Cassius Clay. So, you know, at the time, there weren't a lot of people who, even in my own family, who respected and admired him because they thought he was too braggadocious, you know. I'm pretty, I'm gonna beat you, I'm gonna do this. But for me, I saw him as having a lot of confidence in himself. So as a kid, without knowing any of the politics, the history, any of that, I thought, yeah, I'd like for him to be one of my relatives too. And I didn't even question that I was related to him. I knew I was related to him because he was black and he was modern. He was on TV. He was great. He had courage and he had the same last name. So, you know, in a kid's mind, you're thinking, I know that we're related to him.
I, at one time, worked in Pennsylvania and I would go up to Deer Lake and talk to them up there, you know, and Mohammed would be working out and Rockmine would be there. And I got pictures of him hitting a heavy bag. I got pictures of Maymay and the twins, you know, when they were little kids. And, you know, he would get us into a room and start talking to everybody and doing magic tricks and, you know, everybody had a good time.
I've been doing genealogy for many, many years, but one of the things that I was not able to prove for sure was any type of connection to Muhammad Ali. So when people would ask me, I'd say, I don't know because I don't have any DNA. And then several years ago, a relative of Muhammad Ali on the other side of the family, not the Clay side, his name was Keith Winstead. And as it turned out, Keith sent me an email asking me about my husband, Lyle, because he and Lyle share DNA. So he wasn't looking for me, he was looking for Lyle. And so as it turned out, he said, I see that, you know, on your chart, talking to me, that you're a Clay, and I'm also related to Muhammad Ali. And I said, well, I don't know if I am or not. So then that's when he told me the story.
Well, what happened, Muhammad Ali had his DNA on 23andMe, and I didn't know who it was because it was trying to be anonymous. It just had MA. It didn't have any other information. And I was wondering who this MA is, because he's a third cousin. I should know who that he is. But it just said MA, and I didn't know who it was, no other information. Then there was another one that it was anonymous. And I didn't know back then on 23andMe, you could use the username as anonymous. So I matched about 12 or 13 people who had anonymous as a username. And then, so one day I was going through one of these anonymous, and it was Maymay. And she made a mistake. She put her paternal surnames, Clay and Grady, and she put her mother's surnames. And I said, well, this got to be a descendant of Muhammad Ali. So one day I was looking at this MA and it said daughter, anonymous. So I said, oh, wow, now I know who this MA is. It's Muhammad Ali because he is the father of this anonymous who is Maymay. When Maymay came into town, I asked her if she did that test and she said, yes, she did. So she and her father did the DNA test.
So Keith said, well, let me do some research and see. And I gave him access, you know, to my brother's DNA and to my DNA. When he did the match, he did it with Rockmine. And of course, Rockmine would be Muhammad's brother. And we matched. And I felt like I had a home run. Mm-hmm. That was more exciting for me, to go to Kentucky and to connect with that part of my family, because that meant that we had been separated. You know, I was really excited when I met Rockmon. Uh-huh. He was so warm and so nice. And in my intuitive self, I believed that we were cousins. Uh-huh. And when I met him, I felt it. Uh-huh. I felt it. And you know what's interesting, Mary, as he said, he felt it too.
Oh, really?
Mm-hmm. So Muhammad Ali, in my family, was a hero. He was a big icon, not just in my family, in the world family, but for me, being related to Muhammad Ali would give you a sense of pride because he was someone in our society that wanted good for society.
I brag about Gay and the work that she does with my coworkers back in Texas. And every so often I do bring it up that we are related to Cassius Clay. I always use that word, that name, to see if people know exactly who I'm talking about. And then when I say Muhammad Ali, they kind of bring it up.
Doing my research on the Clay family, I just think it's ironic that there are a lot of famous white Clays, but perhaps the most famous Clay is a black man.
So the first thing that I'm going to do is start centering this piece. So that's even compression at the top and on the sides. And the reason why you're doing this is because you need all of the clay to be one. So right now it's a whole bunch of people in here at this time, and they're trying to get together to actually be traveling in the same circle.
We have to recognize that we have everything in us, and so we have the responsibility to reflect as human beings on what shaped our lessons, what shaped our experiences, what shaped our environment, and then choose what we want to do with that and how we want to learn from it. Genealogy is interesting, but it should not be decisive or determinative as to who we are. We have to build our own character based on our own choices, and I think studying our genealogy and studying the choices and the history behind us can be helpful in helping us discern our own path, not so much because the people from whom we are descended by blood give us some sort of innate direction, but because their own stories can be instructive for us. They can be lessons for us.
And we can learn from them without repeating it. And of course, nowadays, obviously, we don't own slaves, but we got plenty of other cultural issues between blacks and whites and Hispanics, and it hasn't gone away. It has evolved in some good ways and some bad ways, but all we can do is try to put one foot in front of the other and do better than what the people before us did.
We're here now. They're gone. When they were here, they had a choice of who they associated with and what they did. And we should not be bound by the choices that they made to the extent that that is possible. What choices are we making today that make it easier for those who come after us to continue that progress and that movement towards bending the arc of the moral universe towards justice?
But I'm feeling so much solace that what I was intended to do has been taken care of now, to find, because I may never find Henry's parents, but I found other people along the way, and I feel very comfortable with my tree. You know, that I feel like I don't have to look at anymore, that's it. And so it might be that it's the next generation that finds Henry. Right. It might not be intended for me.
I've made an effort to find the people in my family who are interested in what I'm doing, because I want to be able to turn it over to them.
Yes.
And fortunately, one of my daughters turned out to be one of those people.
Mm-hmm. And I think there comes a point in time that you become interested. I really did not become that interested until I became a mother. My identity was important to me and important to my children. So at least they had the, you know, what I did, and to preserve it so that when I'm gone, they'll be able to preserve it and pass it on to their children. And I never think that anything's by accident that we're here. So I think it was preordained.
Because I had to do all this research. I knew nothing.
Yeah.
I knew nothing.
Right.
I did not expect to be connected to this family.
Yeah. Well,
at all. I'm glad I am.
I'm glad you are too.